I want to talk about some high-resolution aeromagnetic data. Amber Kolbekovic is going to talk about some radiometric data over epithermal gold deposit called El Aguila. That's an historic mine. It's mined out now. And La Arista, these are epithermal gold deposits in Oaxaca State, Mexico. I want to thank Gold Resource Corporation and their Mexican subsidiary, Don David Gold, for allowing us to present this, this material. Also, Barry Devlin, Vice President of Exploration, who was very helpful in kind of guiding the exploration there, keeping me straight on the geology. I asked him if he wanted to be co-author on this paper, and he said, no, no way. And so that tells me something right there. But these deposits, at La Arista, since they started mining in July of 2010, they've moved about 800,000 tons of material, average grade 3.85 grams per ton gold, 290 grams per ton silver. Mined out about 82,000 ounces of gold, about 7 million ounces of silver. So it's not a bad deposit. And it's still going. Pardon me. Location. Here's the state of Oaxaca, which is kind of the center of, I think it's tequila, or not tequila, it's a mezcal, I think, and quite famous for that. But the property is located about 40 kilometers southeast from the state capital of Oaxaca. This is the property boundary for Don David Gold. And we flew the general area through here with airborne, high-resolution airborne magnetic radiometric. We're going to take a look at that full survey, but we're going to concentrate for magnetic purposes right down here at the La Arista mine and the El Aguila. We'll take a look at that in a little bit more detail. First, I want to address this issue of high resolution because I put it in my title. I don't really want to be beat up for that, for using that, but I started thinking about that term and what that means. For me, I first thought about it when cesium vapor magnetometer put in aircraft, shows you my vintage. But it seems to be kind of a loosely used term that applies to either line spacing or equipment specification, or light height, or the telecopter fixture. Maybe it's more clearly defined in some other venues, but Ted Urquhart did a pretty good job he presented a paper to the PDAC this last March, and I borrowed this slide from him. These are his conclusions, where he really talks about high-resolution helicopter magnetic data in high topography, very rough topography, primarily through Chile and Peru and into Mexico. He did quite a nice job, and he's got his paper on their website, and I was just going to take a look at it. Well, one thing that came home to me was this issue of sampling with the magnetometer. They sampled their magnetometer at 50 hertz. I think most systems, helicopter systems, sample at 10 hertz. And as it turns out, there's a cooling fan in a lot of these helicopters. In rough topography, when it kicks off or shuts down, there's like a DC shift in the measurement stuff. You know, sometimes 0 to maybe 10 nanoteslas. And it's correlated with topography. And without sampling at 50 hertz, you don't see it. And so if you don't see it, you don't know it's there. And but if you sample 50 hertz, you can identify it and correct it. So I would refer you to this paper. It's quite a nice paper on his website where he discusses this issue of what he refers to as high resolution helicopters. This is the survey that we we flew out in outlined in black here. This is on a background of a composite, the 1:50,000 scale Mexican government geology map. We flew it about north 51 degrees east, line spacing, at 300 meters. The idea is we would fly this whole area, and as it was ongoing, we would select areas out of that to do 100 meter infill. The mean terrain clearance for survey was 31 meters, standard deviation of 11 meters, which is pretty good. A lot of times you see a low terrain clearance, but it'll vary from 500 meters to 2 meters, so, which is probably not any good helicopter when they did that. But anyway, they used a Bell 206L1 helicopter, which is Ted's favorite. So what you're seeing here in black is the area that we flew, the regional survey, the infill of these areas that are in blue, black areas of the regional survey. The blue areas are the 100 meter, and I'm going to focus right down in this focus area in red, which is right around. This is the La Arista mines. It's an underground epithermal vein system here. The El Aguila is an open pit, but it's also an epithermal. It's mined down. We'll look at this in a little bit more detail. Geologically, what's going on here is the oldest rocks in the area are Cretaceous sediments. These are arenites, carbonates, some shales, some intermediate volcanics. Overlying these are, in the brown tones, are tertiary volcanics, volcanic plastic flows, ignimbrites and andesites, some pre-post mineral. These have been intruded by these red, there's actually a different color red here, but I can't tell the difference. This is a granite diorite. Turns out it's not magnetic. And also tertiary rhyolites. Both of these are responsible for driving the epithermal systems in many of these mineralized districts that you see throughout the area, as well as throughout a lot of Mexico. So, this is the total field aeromagnetic map. Okay? And the first thing I want to point out is that, you know, the structural grain that we're seeing in this west-northwest direction of the lineages is the fabric of mineral controlling structures that we see at the mining operation. Here's where the, here's the El Aguila, La Arista, I mean, it's not exposed. It's an underground mine right here. This is the one, this is El Aguila, and it is a pit mine down. So you get this structural fabric, sure, you can see that. That structural fabric is cut off in places by really prominent northerly trending extensional structures that basically drop down sin and post-mineral volcanics, strongly magnetic volcanics here to the east and to the south. These are ridge-forming ignimbrites, very magnetic, very typical, strongly magnetic flows. These are younger and post-mineral. You can do a little bit of mapping of which volcanic system or flows you want to be dealing with. Because you see that these structures are coming up in here, and they're kind of terminated by these younger flows. They're a little bit more difficult to trace through here. They're probably under there, but these are clearly post-structure. Okay, and we'll look at this area. I think I have that red diagram around there. Only I would put a red square on a red image. But anyway, some interesting things come out of this. These large kind of subdued areas are areas where here, this area here, they're either what we see when we look at them. They're either areas of thin volcanic cover where you're looking down into the Cretaceous sedimentary section, or you have rhyolites have intruded in some cases, sealed out places. So you got the combination, those rhyolites are not magnetic. And in many cases, the granodiorites are not magnetic, particularly up in here, okay? Now, so we're interested in those, where these sediments are exposed, because the idea on the property is this is kind of a piston-shaped model where rhyolites have shoved the whole system up and exposed the Cretaceous sedimentary section. So, I think that's all I would, oh yeah, this little high right here. You know, what drives these epithermal systems? Well, that's always kind of the question. A lot of times they're rhyolites and hard to see in the magnetic data, which you have some kind of contrast. We like to see magnetic highs that we can postulate that might be ancillary subvolcanic feeder zones or more mafic intrusive rocks that might have generated the system, generated the heat to drive the epithermal system. I see that a lot in working in South America, and a lot of the epithermal systems, they seem to be occurring on the boundaries of fairly high magnetite volcanic rocks, where it's hard to pick where the bottom is, but you makes you wonder whether you're getting fairly close to where the system has been fed. So we're kind of interested in finding some of these really strongly magnetic rocks that might be subvolcanic or intrusive. This is the reduced pole, which we look to do. And it does square things away a little bit. You know, you get the piece of post-mineral ignimbrites over here, and it doesn't really do a whole lot as we would suspect to straighten that out, because you got a lot of remnants, I'm sure, going on in these rocks, as well as some of the rocks that locally have been around the property. Interesting thing around this area are these areas are turning into a little bit mag highs. And that's kind of curious. Even that's a subtle mag high. So here's an area we know there's rhyolite intrusive in here. We expected that this subdued pattern that you see here is alteration, and or replacement of some of the volcanics with rhyolites and rhyolite cores. Our postulated intrusive or subvolcanics sitting right here. So these gray pockets of strongly negative mag response suggest that remnants may be part of that package of rocks as well. Okay, geology section for the property. Basically, life starts to happen for us about right here. We've got intermediate volcanics and sediments of the Cretaceous, okay, interbedded in places. On top of that, we've got some shale units in the upper part of the sedimentary package. They're in some places there, some places not. Starting in the tertiary, we've got a conglomerate. We've got conglomerates that are very common. And then overlying andesitic and multi-phase volcanic flows. Now, these are all intruded by these diorites, granodiorites, and rhyolites. And in that process, the mineralization on the property consists of scar development in the carbonate sequences here. Some epithermal brecciation, Stockford vein in the intermediate volcanics. Not much host, so we don't actually have these sediments much on the property. These conglomerates, when you get up into the system, it blows out, and you get massive silicification, Stockford vein, and gold mineralization in these conglomerates are quite nice resistivity targets. And of course, classic epithermal vein mineralization up in the andesitic sequence, and then you get post-mineral volcanics as we saw to the south of the property. So that's kind of the mineralization story on the property. This is the geology map of the property. And I'm going to retain the outlines of the various lithologies as I go through the geophysical maps. In green, the oldest rocks we have. as the sedimentary sequence. Overlying that in fault contact are pre-mineral, host, and acidic intermediate volcanic rocks. Through here, blue, out in here, here, and here. These have been intruded by rhyolites here, 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 and here. By the way, this is the Elagila, underground mine. This is surface projection. There's a little deposit right in here that is called El Eri. It's the historic mine. It comes to the historic mine that this was found on, and this comes to the surface. The mined out El Aguile deposit sits right over in here in these rhyolites. Shown in red here is the mapped silicification within the rhyolites, and it's massive, okay? Massive to brecciafill and through here, here, even in the sediments. So this is obviously a very, very active system. So we kind of have, the younger units are these agglomerates, andesitic agglomerates that you see in contact here with the andesites, premineral andesites. There, across the river here to the south, are amphorites. These are ridge formers. They're very nasty customers to deal with from a magnetic standpoint, as you'll see. And these are all post-mineral cover. So the task, at least in the property, sort of the brownfields exploration here, is kind of two things. Where do we follow this mineralization here, the epithermal mineralization? Where do we find new targets here in these andesites? And what is the story here with skarn mineralization that we know we get underground here when we intersect the carbonate sequence? What is the potential for that kind of mineralization down here? This is a total field map. Inclination here is 44 degrees. And pretty neat. You see the contact here with the ignimbrites to the south, typical volcanic sequence of magnetic response, where, you know, we look at that and we go, boy, those are volcanics, and then we kind of talk about this stuff, you know. And the very subtle magnetic pattern in the exposed sedimentary sequence, which we would expect, because we know them to not be magnetic, for the most part. The andesites are magnetic, over in here. And these post-mineral agglomerates are certainly magnetic. Here is this big magpie over here that we would like it to be a stock or feeder zone, subvolcanic, whatever. Looks like there might be some remnants going on, as I previously discussed. And you can see a sense of the lineation that we get in the magmatic data. You can actually see it coming down here through these presumably post. Did you say time? What happens when you get on a chart here?
Can you voice it?
Yeah, it is. I thought my wire. But you can see that you see the lineation here going into these agglomerates, which means that some of those may be sand mineral, maybe at the base, or maybe the structures that control that deposition here were preferentially eroded, and so that you get a different depositional pattern of these volcanics on top. Nonetheless, for linear mapping, you can see them going through here, even though these are post minerals. North-south structure, pretty well defined. A lot of interesting character linears that we will be prospecting through here in the andesites. This is the mill. We found the mill. And we get over here, we're starting to get into the post-mineral volcanics again. Now, we're interested in if this indeed is some sort of a piston affair where this sedimentary sequence was pushed up. We're interested in what the character of these magnetic highs are that are sitting down here within the sedimentary sequence as potential skarn mineralization, because if this was pushed up, this would be a good area for structural preparation along the boundary. And we do see scar mineralization at depth below the epithermal veins here at La Arista. So, here's the rhyolites with accompanying silicification in a mag low, shifted a little bit to the south, which you would expect at that kind of inclination. So we're kind of happy about all that. This is the reduced to pole image. And in some places it gets a little bit easier to understand, in some places it doesn't. The structural boundaries become a little bit more clear, defining the area. We know that at La Arista we have pre and sen diorites that intrude along the same mineral hosted structure. And if you go underground, you measure core with your little zapper meter and go across. Sometimes the alteration window is a meter, sometimes it's 10 meters. And so fundamentally, you don't get a lot of magnetite destructive alteration over a width that would be really seeable here with this 100 meter line space survey. But we're interested in that because they use the same structures. And in places, they are mineralized. So obviously, when we've got linears and we've got these mag highs that are sitting down here, we're interested in some of those things. The plant, of course, went berserk with the reduced pole. And this started to become of interest. You know, what is the nature of this big mag high that's kind of sitting down here? Now, we know that we've got enough magnetic susceptibility measurements on the sequence here that when you're trucking along in the sediments, particularly around a scar, and it can be it's pyrrhotite, and it's very magnetic. I mean, it can be 01, 04, 05 over very localized small areas, but it's spotty, and so in volume, it turns out that an interesting scar package might average, 004, 003 SI. So even though it's highly magnetic locally, in at the scale of the potential addressing target, it's averaged out. So that, I think, is the nature of why we might have some of these broad magnetic highs. So we're interested, okay, where are the targets? And you would have gone, if you had this map, we would have gone and stuck some holes in here. So what we did is I did the analytic signal. All right, well, here we go. Now here's the truth detector. There's not a whole lot of magnetic sources going on in here. Well, that kind of fits the geology because this rhyolite is not magnetic. Certainly the silicification is not. We pick up our diorite in here. That's an interesting target. The boundaries of the postulated feeder zone over here. We can talk about that all day. The nice thing about that is it's on another ahedo, which they won't let us on. And so we'll never find out about that. So I just say just about ahedo. But this is a pretty decent correlation with the trendology of the massive silicification that you see and the rhyolite. So the model seems to fit pretty well. We also have again, some interesting targets down here. These little stars here, these three stars, I'm going to follow those in the next few slides. And, the character of the analytic signal is pretty robust. And if it's a dike-like feature that has a large depth extent, as you know, it produces a high, independent of magnetic field inclination, induced field inclination, and remnants. It seems to be fairly robust at doing that. When it's more of a plate-like body, the highs tend to form on the edge. Okay? And we sort of wonder, well, is that maybe what's going on here? You see it very subtle in the blue areas. Okay? And are we starting to see maybe some edges of more plate-like bodies that would be more consistent with scar development along that carbonate sequence in the sedimentary section? So those were still of interest to us. We got the plant. Oh, So basically what we did, you've seen kind of this slide earlier. Karamish talked about the magnetic vector conversion, which became available last April 2012, I believe. And I've used it a lot up and down in South America, Mexico, Chile. I've had pretty good results with it. And when I mean pretty good results, not just being paid, but I mean pretty good results in the sense that we generate sources where people have drill holes, and you get magnetic rocks of sort of the fuzzy boundary that you've generated the source. That's pretty good. And some of these rocks that we deal with have strong ribbon magnetization, is what we saw here, and other places that I've worked. But basically, as you have an induced magnetic field, in this case it's vertical, a remnant field here, the resultant pointing in this direction, and they invert on the total magnetization vector, and you get an amplitude, and you get a component that's parallel to the induced field, and one that's perpendicular. The idea being that this would be dominated by remnants, and this would be dominated by induced magnetization. I really haven't worked with these components a whole lot. I'm mainly interested at this point in the amplitude of this, which is kind of like, this is kind of like a fake susceptibility. That's kind of my naive way of looking at it. That includes remnants and includes the induced magnetic field. So we did this inversion. We did actually this inversion and the MBI inversion, and we did a conventional inversion. I'll show you the results of both. This is the MBI susceptibility amplitude at a depth of 200 meters below surface. Okay, now it's starting to look a whole lot like that analytic signal result. Okay, and that made me feel pretty good. Okay, we've got this structural massive solidification zone in here. We've got the diorite in here. We've got these little things here that we can look at, and in the andesitic package, we have. Now we have, remember the analytic signals was forming little highs around the edges here. These little subtle features right in here, right? We think they're real. That one there, and this is a more of a dike-like feature, but the MBI did a pretty good job of sorting that out and picking the edge quite nicely down here. So we were concerned about to what extent the magnetic effect of this embrite was flowing over, because this is a high relief area. And so we wanted to separate that out, and it seems like this inversion has done a pretty good job of that. We still have the plant problem, and of course, and I make light of that, but you know, this is a problem that at least I have with inversion, because I'm not giving it the right constraints or whatever. But you know, we have a highly magnetic area, and certainly its bottom doesn't go down to 200 meters below topography. And so we get this kind of tail. And it's obviously, it's so magnetic, it's such a strong anomaly that it's not resolving its bottom very well. And I know there are some focusing things, some constraints that we can do on the inversion. If we were really interested in resolving that on an individual basis, we could do that. But, okay, now let's take a look at, I'm going to look at two sections through here as well. This section here and this section here. Let's go to the conventional inversion. And keep your kind of your mind's eye right on these guys right in here. And the next slide, this is the conventional inversion, okay? Susceptibility inversion at 200 meters below surface. And things have kind of, I don't want to say they've gone wild, but it's a little bit more difficult for me to believe these results, okay? Mainly, there's two criteria. It doesn't match the analytic signal results, and geologically it doesn't match our geology. And so, you know, it's going to take a long time before you're going to say, well, the geophysics doesn't match the geology, what we know to be in the geology. I'm going to be hard-pressed to believe it. Of course, it's done nothing to resolve the issue down here in these ignimbrites, and our little intrusive up here has gone a little bit berserk. Previous one. It's now kind of nice round little analytic signal type device. Now we have some geometries on it, and we have some shapes to it. Despite the remnants that we suspect is going on in that. Okay, so let's take a look at this first section right here. Okay, right to the deposit. And we've got drill control here, and that always makes me feel comfortable. We've got some of that kind of stuff going on. The color coding here is, they've done a lot of drilling here. This is like, it's only like a 100 meter window on either side. And there actually is a little bit of gray up in here. That gray colorization is any volcanic, antecedent volcanic, excluding rhyolites that sits in the sequence up in here. Epithermal mineralization. We have the green are the sediments, and the brown is scar mineralization. And they're taking, and the black are the epithermal veins. So they're taking gold mineralization, and they're also recovering the base metal mineralization from the scars. So you can see that this on top here is the amplitude component, with the MBI version. On the bottom is the conventional susceptibility version. Well, we know, what do we know about here? What's a fact that we can use to qualify this? We know that this is the area of the bathysphere silicification, and the rhyolite truth, this very low blue area. This is down in the 005 range. So, you know, it's essentially, it's not going to pull your magnet. It's not going to pull your magnet until you start getting up into the yellows. And I expect even in these skarns, there are local areas that will pull your magnet that are highly more magnetic, but not continuous over a long distance. Some of these holes are projected in and out of the section, and it changes from section to section quite a bit. We know that these are andesites up here. And we're doing, you know, we're sort of, you know, this is not a focused, IFR, ISR, constraining version, where you're kind of constraining, trying to focus the bottoms. So this does have some tails that go down in here. I was interested in kind of keeping those in there because we're interested in some of these areas with potential scar mineralization, as well as over in here. This boundary is pretty well defined. This boundary here with the ignimbrites to the south, very typical when you have a lot of, in my experience, very typical when you have a lot of remnants in the volcanic package. At the edges, you'll get a strong high, low, high, and then boom, and it just looks weird. Now, the client would really prefer this model. This is the conventional model. These are fairly magnetic rocks here, if you believe the susceptibilities. These would be good targets, but I don't think that they're real. I think that they're probably artifacts of the inversion and maybe local. I don't completely understand what the difference is, but they certainly don't show up in this inversion up in here. So something gone haywire in here, but we'll still be looking at it because there's not, you know, the thing about these skarns is that pyrrhotite's very strongly magnetic and localized. It's very likely carrying pretty strong remnants locally. So I think that it's the conventional inversion is interpreted that as some highs, some susceptibility highs. Our area of our intrusive area is sort of not. That is, it's a little bit better constrained here. We're a little bit south east of it. Again, you wouldn't get too excited about that, or I certainly wouldn't. The next section, this is a little bit closer to our postulated intrusive. Now we're starting to, you know, this is the sedimentary package. It's pretty well with our geology, so I feel good. You know, we is this a piston-shaped thing that's been shoved up by perhaps feeders of rhyolite? Yeah, I'm sure that's a great model for that. Maybe that's really the case. But these are knowns. We know that these are sediments. We know that these are rhyolites. They're silicified, and they're not magnetic at all. It's a little bit more complicated picture down here in the conventional inversion. Again, something weird going on in the ignimbrites, but we don't have any indication of our intrusive. And we're pretty certain that this is case. This is right on the boundary where we're getting our spar mineralization, so we'll be following this thing to the north as well. So, and perhaps little things like this, because even though that's very subtle, there could be some fairly sizable areas of scar mineralization that could be quite massive locally. So this would be a target for us. And interestingly, it is resolved sort of in the conventional version. Okay, well that's all I have to say about the magnetic data. This is sort of my observations. These are pretty obvious, I think, to everybody in this room. Aeromagnetic data is useful for mapping lithology, alteration of structure in epithermal environments. Almost everybody is here is going to agree with that. You still get the offhand comment occasionally. You know, geophysics doesn't work. How do you interpret that comment? And survey specifications and contractor selection and qualified oversight are important. They make a difference in defining specific targets. They're in my stomping ground, which is the Americas. From basically sometimes in the U.S., but Mexico south. We have a selection of contractors, and we're fortunate. And all of them do a pretty good job, but there are differences in how they approach the survey and the details that they put into it. And so it is important to have somebody looking at that. And I think they all do an excellent job of really doing the best survey possible. I've had very few problems, and I've run across data sets. They were flown that I was not involved in, and I've seen very few that were bad. I think we're very fortunate to have such good contractors in at least my software. But there are differences, and it's important to look at those differences. And now, the magnetic and vector inversion, I hope I haven't been too strong about it. I really like it. I think it's a real major innovation in our interpretation of magnetic data. Even though Rob Ellis at GeoSoft was that group was the developer of this, and I'm not doing that because it's not me. It's him, which is exactly the same name. But they've really done an extraordinary job there. And it's also nice because you can do an inversion and you kind of set it up, ship it off, and pay quite a reasonable fee because it sends off, you get an inversion back in a matter of hours as opposed to running time up your machine for days. So it's quite a handy way to work on things. And again, when we're working in these environments, making the assumption that the Earth's magnetic field is just one uniform direction is clearly a difficult assumption. When we, 20 years ago, when we first got the UBC inversion, and boy, what a major advancement. What a major advancement that was for our ability to interpret airborne gravity, airborne magnetics and gravity data. And like anything, time moves on, a little bit twists and turns to the technology, and I think that this MVI version is a good one. At least it's been very good for some of the work that I've had. I'm going to turn this over to Amherst, who will talk about the radiometric data. He's done a lot of work in hyperspectral imaging of satellite hyperspectral data. And he's quite adept at manipulating that data and those data. And he's applied some of those techniques to the radiometric data. So I'll turn it over to Amherst.
So Bob only left me 10 minutes, so I'll try to do the lossless compression here and try to compress 20-minute talk in 10 minutes. So I'm going to talk really fast like those guys on the auction house. Give me 20, right here, 40. Anyway, so I guess you get a minute for each year of experience you had. So Bob took his 40, I'm going to take my 10. And we'll keep on trucking. So in any case, the radiometrics data was sort of like the ugly stepchild of geophysics. Normally you get it for free. It's sort of like going out on a date and the little brother comes along. So what we're actually going to try to do up here is try to make some sense out of radiometrics data and turn it into a useful ally in the global war against geology. So what we are going to do is stay away from the 1970s air processing, which was essentially using the band ratios and composites to create images that then we can interpret the way the geophysicists do. And we're going to try to do something that's normally done in the imagery world. So using and treating radiometrics data as point data rather than just kind of some amorphous mass. So what we're going to do is try to look at a spectral dimension of it, see if you can actually take spectra to derive useful information. Now the man has been using this for a while. I mean, this is one of the few things that the man has allowed us to use. So the man was using radiometrics data to look for interesting fissile materials on the surface to keep the evildoers from getting their hands on things they aren't supposed to get on. And then also to monitor and track and do quite a bit of modeling and emergency preparedness. So if you try to move an X-ray machine, a couple of guys in cheap suits and cheap rental cars are going to come down and pay you a visit. So as you can see, there is definitely a spectral dimension that can be used in this kind of endeavor. And we're actually going to try to do, and what I was trying to do in this whole exercise, was to take a data set that's fairly, correlated, and then decorrelated into different components that can be then used to get you a better idea of what kind of surface exposures or manifestations you have and things down the depth. Now, in this realm, Bob has already told you what's underground, so we're actually going to go from the standpoint that radiometrics data is kind of easier to analyze, so you will do this first before you start doing all your fancy magnet versions. So, normally, as you can see, with the modern-day spectrometers, we actually get a whole spectral component. So we actually have different regions where different elements are sensed in the emissive portion of the gamma ray spectrum. Now, as you can see, if you just take your standard potassium, thorium, uranium, they're fairly correlated. So you're going to get your standard pasta dish. And then up here, you start getting, when you start doing the principal components analysis, you can actually divide the data set in different groups that can be then used to interpret them in a lot, I guess, more streamlined approach. Now, OASIS montage is not suited for this. I mean, it's not really designed to interpret radiometrics data in the data cube domain. It's treating as a grid. PRAGA, which is an add-on that comes on, is only moderately capable because it gives you some principal components analysis. Now, what you essentially have to do is go from the grid domain and go into data cube domain. So essentially go from treating the radiometrics data set as a grid data set and treat it as a data cube data set. So what I've used is the program called ENVI, which is normally used for this image processing, spectral band math, and so on. And then idea is to, you get your spectral data with your radiometrics data set from reputable providers. And then what you would actually try to do is you would look for signatures. Now, back in the 80s, and one of the colleagues says, "You're talking just rubbish. We progressed in 1968. It didn't quite work." So in any case, you have to stay away from your statistical things. You have to look for signatures. In Australia, they've done a lot of work at gamma ray, and they caution against the whole scene classification. But if you go with the a priori knowledge and you define what your signatures are, and you know what are your sediments, your rhyolites, your andesites, and so on, then you have a lot better chance at actually making a good classification as opposed to making a bad one. So, in a sense, you take the spectra and you look at different components of the spectrum. So, for example, in this component, you have all of them low. Here you have uranium, potassium high, uranium low, and thorium sort of high. So you get different classes, so you actually generate a lot more bands that you can do that. Now, if your computer is more sophisticated, you can go down the spectral domain and start looking at the actual spectral emissions or absorptions. And then most of them are dominated by potassium, But you know, there are certain ways that you can go about it and look at small, subtle differences. Now, what's working against us in this whole exercise is that we do not have good spectral libraries that we can actually say, okay, this is my rhyolite, this is my ultraviolet. The man does, but the man ain't sharing. So if you look at the rhyolite composite spectrum, so all of the classes that spatially correspond with mapped rhyolite, if you look at andesite, so all of the gamma ray spectra from that thing, you can actually see there are small, subtle differences between them in potassium emissions and uranium emissions. You can see that uranium is a lot more prevalent in the rhyolite than it is in andesite. So just on some of these small absorptions and peaks, you can differentiate the rhyolite and andesite. And if you look at, for example, unaltered rhyolite versus altered rhyolite, you can actually see a lot more uranium. And there is that whole correlation between gold and uranium and a few other things that go hand in hand. So by looking at spectra and actually treating the spectra as something that guides you towards the classification, you'll actually do a lot better job. So we're not looking for a needle in the haystack. I mean, the needle in the haystack is already there. So the easiest way to do and find the needle in the haystack is to remove the haystack. So we're actually trying to look at a way to remove the background, because we don't care about things that are superfluous to finding gold or copper or anything like that, but focus on particular classes that we would like to know. Where's my altered rhyolite? Where's my andesite? You know, and so we're going to treat each point as an individual measurement. So each one of these things is going to have a signature. Just as I can say, you know, Bob Ellis is there because I know him. I know how he looks like. I know what his signature is. That's how I can go after my altered rhyolite. So in this huge data cloud that you have of each individual point that's spectrally, spatially distinct from the other ones, you can actually look at them at different spaces. So you're shooting vectors through the data. And the more pixels, or actually these points are intersected by vectors, the more spectrally distinct they are. So they start going towards the edges of the clouds. You spin these clouds, it looks kind of like a death star. So you have these different clouds that are going on, and each one is separating different classes of those particular rock units or alteration minerals present on the surface. You do this in the imagery world, and it works pretty good. You get all these nice alteration maps. There's no reason why you shouldn't be able to do that in the gamma ray world, because after all, spectrum is a spectrum. So with the defined end member, you can then carry out classification. One set of those end members in the data cloud, I have another one, I have another one. They're all spectrally and spatially distinct. These little lines are where the narcos have the land, so you don't go there, I say. And so you can actually refine the classes and plot your pixels between that, so likelihood versus the infeasibility. So only the good ones that actually really identify the particular class are the pixels that you're going to use in classification. So, you know, if you look at it, this is your standard radiometric ternary map for a zoomed-in view of the mineralized area that Bob was just talking about. And here's the way it looks like when you actually do this both semi-qualitative, semi-quantitative interpretation, suggesting that you have these different classes that you have actually picked up from the data cloud. So you get a lot more complexity. You actually start seeing these areas of altered rhyolite and that area around the intrusive that Bob had mentioned to be quite interesting. So when you add geology to it, and you can actually see that lots of these different classes correspond with some of the mapped units that we see up here. So here's our alteration trend. Here are our sediments. Again, more alteration. So here's an area that's of interest to the entire exercise at hand. And then the good thing with radiometrics and all the supportive data sets that you can use, normally you will do this first. So the ugly brother comes in first, you take care of his needs first, and then you move on to real geophysics. So you would actually do this to give you ideas of surface manifestations. And then you can do all your modeling and see that some of these alteration zones correspond with the zones of drilling and other areas of exploration interest. So by adding a data set that already comes with your normal MAG data, you already give yourself a tactical edge in global war against geology, because geology is always playing jokes on us anyways. So, in any case, as far as the radiometrics are concerned, with some a priori knowledge, so all of us have a geological map, it's fairly easy to observe this radiometric data in the spectral or emissive domain. Traditional methods are left back in the 70s. I mean, the spectrometers are there, the spectral information is there, so might as well try to use it. And the computing power is definitely catching up to it. By expanding the classes and not just binning everything in the three basic categories, uranium, thorium, potassium, but looking at 7, 10, 15 categories, you can actually get better classification in a different area. The problem that we actually have, you barely scratch the surface on it. Not too many people do this stuff in the regular exploration world. As I said, the man has been doing it quite a bit, so looking for all kinds of different things. And treating the radiometrics in the way that we treat remote sensing spectroscopy or thermal spectroscopy, this is something that we should probably move towards to, but unfortunately the software and the analysis tools really have to catch up with it. So treat it more as a point measurement rather than just turning your maps, and you can actually create some more pretty pictures for your clients and get better ideas of what's going on below the ground. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Aaron and Bob. We might have time for one quick question.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. I want to talk to you later. Question back then. Or comment. That last section where you have the standard inversion and then the MVI one, right? It bothered me because it looked like there was nothing there in the standard. But when I looked at the image, it's negative, which is how the UBC code interprets pan remnants. It's actually a fairly strong negative, but it just goes blue, because we don't assign colors into the negative zone. So I was curious. So that to me, the MVI, as you said, it's a fake susceptibility. It sort of treats remnants and induced together to give you the product.
Right.
But the actual UBC code, or the standard UBC code, is, I call it doing the best it can.
And doing it
exactly. Exactly. But if you look at those negatives, that we often see that in sort of, so you know, that's how it expresses itself. It's a remnants effect.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's interesting. I've never understood what those negatives were. And in some places, the name carbonate section. Those anomalies were kind of interesting. And, I can tell you, they'll probably drill some of them anyway. I don't want to walk away from the star mineralization, but it did leave me a little bit. The overall MBI version did kind of match in general what we knew about the geology, but within that set of entry sequence, there were some targets in the conventional.